Welcome to the distinguished lecture series of the Indian Mathematics Consortium. The aim here is to host virtual colloquia by some of the best researchers and expositors around the world. The speakers are carefully chosen by the scientific committee from among mathematicians who are not only distinguished researchers, but are also known for the quality of their exposition. The principal aim here is to make the talks as widely accessible as possible, especially to PhD students. With this in view, the format of most of the talks will be in two stages. First, there will be a pre-recorded talk by the speaker, which will be posted online. Interested audience can then view this at their leisure and communicate questions, if any, to the organizers. The second stage will be a live interactive session between the speaker and interested participants, and that will be held about 2 weeks after posting the online talk. The approximate duration of the talk will be about 45 minutes, and that of the interactive session will be about half an hour. The Distinguished Lecture Series is co-hosted by IIT Bombay and ICTS Bangalore. Welcome.
It's a real pleasure to introduce Misha Lyubich for this TMC Distinguished Lecture Series. Misha is a leader in dynamical systems and one of the founders of one-dimensional dynamics, both real and complex. In one of his famous early pieces of work, he proved that hyperbolicity is dense in the real quadratic family. He went on and contributed essentially to the theme of renormalization, proving a conjecture of Coulet and Thesa, namely the hyperbolicity of renormalization of unimodal maps. Instead of multiplying examples, let me come quickly to this very celebrated conjecture, MLC, local connectivity of the Mandelbrot set, one of the most famous open conjectures in the field, towards which Misha and his collaborators have made some of the most breathtaking breakthroughs. So, in particular, in joint work with Jeremy Kahn in the first decade of this century, he used the Kahn-Lyubich quasi-additivity law in conformal geometry and made incredible progress. Misha has been recognized for his incredible work for a very long time. I mean, he was an invited speaker at the ICM in Zurich in 1994. He received the 2010 Jeffrey Williams Prize from the Canadian Mathematical Society in 2012. He became a fellow of the American Mathematical Society, and again in 2014, he was an invited plenary speaker at the ICM. Over to Misha.
All right, so here is indeed the Mandelbrot set. So it is just a symbol of holomorphic dynamics, and it is a symbol of the quadratic family. It is just a picture which encodes the whole complexity, the whole dynamical complexity of the complex quadratic family. Well, the simplest nonlinear dynamical system. So you can imagine z squared plus c turns out to be extraordinary complex, actually, and there is this beautiful fractal, complicated fractal set, which just is responsible for this dynamical complexity. So it is a complex set indeed, so difficult to understand, but it turns out remarkably that there is a chance of giving a full description, full understanding of the main topological and geometric features of this set. So modulo some little issue. So, and this issue was going down by Dodi and Hubbard in the 80s. So who put forward the conjecture that the Mandelbrot set is locally connected. And this little conjecture is on our way of essentially complete understanding of this remarkable fractal set. So it is still open, as you can see. And so what my goal today is modest. I will just give you some general introduction to this conjecture. Certainly very familiar for many people in the room, I guess. And then I will update you on the current status of the conjecture, the history of the progress in this question and on the current status. Well, so one of the beauties of this subject that it can be explained essentially to a high school student to can quickly give all main definitions related to the dynamics of the complex quadratic family. So we have the basin of infinity, so consistence of orbits escape into infinity. We have its complement, which is called the Field-Julia set, some compact invariant subset of the complex plane. So with some fractal geometry. And we have the Julia set, which is a common boundary of these two sets. So in the kind of it is some typical picture. So this basin of infinity, Field-Julia set is this dragon, and the skin of the dragon, the boundary is a Julia set. So already here it is clear that it's quite interesting fractal set, though it is one of the simplest ones. And there is a basic classical dichotomy that Julia set and the Field-Julia set is either connected or a counter set, so totally disconnected, and it can be recognized very easily just following the orbit of the critical point. If the orbit of the critical point belongs to the Field-Julia set, then it is connected. If it escapes to infinity, then it is totally disconnected. And then we can partition the complex plane, parameter plane C. So we can partition according to this basic dichotomy, just to define the Mandelbrot set as the set of parameters C for which the Julia set is connected. And that is what this set is. So that is the definition. Of course, it does not tell us much about the structure of this set. So, so we have to work harder to understand a little bit more about this set. So I will not tell you much so about intricate topological structure, but so the basic fact which basically initiated the whole mathematical theory in this subject is a classical theory by Dodi Hubbard, Sibani from 89, which says that the Mandelbrot set is connected. So it is connected set, but actually it was not visible those days on the computer pictures. We need good resolution in order to recognize connectivity. So some people believed that it was actually disconnected, but there was a theorem that stated otherwise. And then shortly afterwards, Dodi and Hubbard put forward this modest conjecture that is now abbreviated. They abbreviated as MLC conjecture. Mandelbrot set is locally connected, and so 40 years later, this conjecture is still open. So, but why it is interesting at all? Why it is interesting at all? So it is interesting for the following reason. So, so what is actually happening in the proof of the connectivity of the Mandelbrot set is much more interesting maybe than the fact itself. It is an explicit construction of the Riemann uniformization of the complement of the Mandelbrot set by the complement of the unit disk. There is an explicit dynamical formula which produces this uniformization. So we have this explicit map, and then we ask ourselves whether this map can be extended to the unit circle. So, and if it does, then it would give some explicit parametrization of the boundary of the Mandelbrot set by the unit circle. And there is a general classical criterion, which is usually called Carassiadori theorem, but so it was a discovery of Flasse that it actually was proven by Torhurst, not by Carassiadori. So let us call it Carassiadori-Torhurst theorem. So according to the Toulasse's suggestion, so and it says that this uniformization does extend to the boundary as long as the Mandelbrot set is locally connected. So the MLC conjecture in this way implies this continuous extension implies parametrization of the boundary of the Mandelbrot set by the unit circle. And what is remarkable is that it is an explicit parametrization. So basically we can, in particular, we can recognize which pairs of points are identified under this parametrization, under this uniformization, and can represent the boundary of the Mandelbrot set as a quotient of the circle by this explicitly given equivalence relation. This equivalence relation was described by Doherty and Hubbard in the 80s. It is by no means it is trivial to do, but it can be done. So, and in this way, the whole Mandelbrot set actually can be represented by the pinched model, by the pinched disk model, in this nice way suggested by Thurston. So you look which external rays, just hyperbolic geodesic in the complement of the Mandelbrot set, which external rays land together at the same points. You take the corresponding angular, so external angular of these rays, and you join them by the hyperbolic geodesic in the unit disk. Think of the unit disk as a hyperbolic plane. And then do this with all collending external rays, and then pinch these geodesics to points, produce natural equivalence relation on the disk. You obtain the pinched disk, some pinched disk set, which is automatically will be locally connected, and it is the model for the Mandelbrot set. So just explicit pinch disk model for the Mandelbrot set, which is automatically locally connected. And if the Mandelbrot set is locally connected, then it is an explicit combinatorial topological model for this complicated fractal set, which was quite remarkable, of course. So that was the main motivation for this conjecture, for the attention to this conjecture. And with this conjecture, we understand topology of the Mandelbrot set. But also there are some other motivations. For instance, one of the other central and classical conjectures in this field is something which is called Fatou's conjecture, which says that hyperbolic maps are dense in the Mandelbrot set. In this particular case of the quadratic family, it boils down to density of hyperbolic parameters in the Mandelbrot set. Hyperbolic parameter is just those C for which the corresponding quadratic polynomial F sub C has an attracting cycle. So that is that simple definition. And that was the conjecture, which was amplified much by the developments of the 60s, Smale's school, when hyperbolicity played so big role, became as one of the central concepts in dynamics. And it turns out that the MLC conjecture implies this Fatou conjecture. So roughly speaking, if you have such an explicit model for the Mandelbrot set, then there is no space for this queer components of the interior of the Mandelbrot set where the maps are not hyperbolic. So one can rule out, and it was also Doherty and Hubbard's results, that one can rule out these queer non-hyperbolic components of the interior of the Mandelbrot set if you know hyperbolicity, if you know MLC, sorry, if you know local connectivity of the Mandelbrot set. And there is another very nice motivation for this problem, which makes it very attractive, is its very deep connection to the most of rigidity phenomenon in the hyperbolic geometry, in particular in the three-dimensional hyperbolic geometry. And in particular, in the way that was given to this phenomenon by Thurston and elimination conjecture, which has suggested a precise geometric model, quasi-isometric model for any non-compact hyperbolic three-dimensional hyperbolic manifold. And this conjecture became a theorem like maybe 15, 20 years ago by the work of Brock, Kennedy, and Minsky. And it turns out that this theorem is exact, so geometric analog of the MLC conjecture. So in geometry, this result was settled down to already a couple of decades ago, but in dynamics, it is still open. So there are various reasons for that, which I will not have time to discuss now. Okay, so that is motivations. I hope that it is all of these are convincing motivations for paying attention to this conjecture. And now let us see what has been done, what kind of progress has been done in the past 40 years. So first, so concept that we need to discuss this progress is the concept of renormalization, which is actually one of the central concepts in dynamics these days. But we will be interested in several types of renormalizations. We will see like three types of renormalizations in this discussion. But the first most important one for us is quadratic-like renormalization. So which is defined as follows. Quadratic-like maps is just a holomorphic double branch covering from a smaller domain to a strictly bigger domain. You consider this as a dynamical object. You start to iterate points. And if the points don't escape to infinity, then you call this set of points the field Julia set. So, and if not to infinity, if they don't escape through the fundamental annulus, so you iterate the points and the point can escape through this fundamental annulus. So if it escapes, then you stop. If it does not escape, then you say that this point belongs to the field Julia set, and you define the Julia set as the boundary of the field Julia set. So it's a basic trivial example. It is just restriction of the quadratic polynomial to sufficiently big disk. Not very interesting example. So, but there is one much more interesting example which introduces renormalization, in which is the motivation for the whole concept. So imagine that you have a little disk. Let us have a Julia set of a quadratic polynomial, this green set, and imagine that you have a little disk around the critical point, which is being iterated forward, comes back under some iterate as a quadratic-like map. So it is mapped onto a bigger disk as a quadratic-like map. So let us look at the Julia set of this quadratic-like map. For this Julia set can be either connected or a counter set. The basic dichotomy applies in the setting of quadratic-like maps, and assume that the Julia set is connected. Then let us say that our quadratic polynomial is renormalizable, and its renormalization is this quadratic-like map. So somehow this renormalization captures dynamics of the original map in some smaller scale. You see, so that is the definition of renormalization, and it comes together with important combinatorial parameter, which is combinatorics of this renormalization. It is first of all the period of this return map. On my picture, it is just period four renormalization, but also it is the placement of these disks of the little Julia sets. You take this little Julia set, you take its iterates, you have on the picture four little Julia sets, and you can, roughly speaking, you can connect them inside of the big Julia set. So to obtain certain graph, which is called a Hubbard tree, and the way they are connected, by this graph is the combinatorial information, combinatorics of our renormalization. So then there are renormalizations with various combinatorics, with arbitrary big periods, and for given periods, usually there are many Hubbard trees, which are responsible for various combinatorics of these renormalizations. And then you can ask ourselves a question. Let us fix combinatorics, so let us fix this Hubbard tree, and consider all quadratic polynomials which are renormalizable with these combinatorics. What is this set of parameters? And the answer was given in a fundamental theorem, again by Doherty and Hubbard from the 80s, which says that what you will see is a little copy of the Mandelbrot set inside of the Mandelbrot set. So for instance, here is a Julia set of maps of a map which is renormalizable with period two. Here is its domain, and the image will be like that. So, and then it will return under the second iterate, it will return back like that. And the corresponding little copy of the Mandelbrot set is on this picture. It is some part of the Mandelbrot set here. It is our copy. There is a homeomorphic copy of the Mandelbrot set attached to this main cardioid here. So you see, there is a difference between this copy and the Mandelbrot set. Mandelbrot set has a cusp here at the 0.25 parabolic cusp, and our copy does not have a cusp. Such a copy is called a satellite copy. Satellite copy, it is attached to the main cardioid, and it is, loses the cusp, but it is still a homeomorphic copy of the big Mandelbrot set. Or here is another harmonization with period 4. Here is the domain, which goes here, then here, and then it comes back as a quadratic-like map. And this combinatorics, this Hubbard tree, you see here, this Hubbard tree specifies for us a little copy somewhere here in the Mandelbrot set. And you see that this copy really looks like a, so a even not topological, but geometric copy, quite precise geometric copy of the big Mandelbrot set with the cusp present here. Such copies are called primitive. So there are two types of copies that we see. Satellite, which are attached to some, to the main cardioid, if it is the first normalization, and primitive copies, which don't attach to anything and which have cusp. And it can be recognized actually dynamically. So dynamically, primitive renormalization corresponds to the fact that these little Julia sets in our orbit, four little Julia sets are pairwise adjoint. It is a feature of the primitive of primitive renormalization. And in satellite case, the little Julia sets, here will be some little Julia set here, and there will be its image will be touch this little Julia set at one point. It is a feature of the satellite normalization. I spent some time on these notions which look like technical subtleties, but actually it is turns out that it is fundamental difference. There is a fundamental difference between this primitive and satellite normalization, and it will be a good part of our today's discussion. So primitive versus satellite cases. Okay, so what it has to do with MLC? So we have this notion of normalization. Yeah, I should say that with this notion, we have a notion of, we can, sometimes we can renormalize map not only one time, but twice, so three times, etc. So we can talk about 100 times renormalizable maps. We can talk about infinite renormalizable maps. If we can keep iterating this procedure to infinity, it would mean that somehow we have some grasp on the small scale structure of our quadratic polynomial in all scales, because high level normalizations capture small scale structure of the map. So we have this, immediately have this classification of quadratic polynomials according to their normalization type. So what it has to do with MLC conjecture. So, and the connection was discovered by Yakos around 1990, who proved the following result, that if we take a parameter C, so then the Mandelbrot set is locally connected at this parameter, unless F sub C, unless the corresponding quadratic polynomial infinitely renormalizable. And so unless this parameter belongs to a nest of copies, of little copies of the Mandelbrot set corresponding to various renormalizations of increasing periods. Okay, so of course, I don't have much time to talk about tools the results that I will mention, but let me say that every progress so far in the MLC conjecture usually introduced some new tool which turned out to be useful, powerful for many other problems. So for understanding fine fractal geometry of Julia sets and the Mandelbrot set, understanding the problem of area and Hausdorff dimensions, these kind of problems. And whenever you have a progress in the MLC, there is an opening in all these problems. And in particular, Yakos introduced the techniques, which is called Yakos puzzle, going back actually to the work of Branner and Hubbard. So which so it is some kind of partitions of the Julia sets in the Mandelbrot set in a very precise dynamical way, and some machinery of analyzing conformal geometry of these partitions by estimated annuli of certain moduli of certain annuli. Okay, but I cannot go inside into this technical discussion. But what is important for us for today is that due to a causal theorem, there is a deep connection between MLC and the renormalization theory. Renormalization theory is a theory which studies asymptotic behavior of renormalizations or studies the small-scale structure of dynamical systems by means of the normalization operator. And MLC, due to Yakov's MLC, was essentially embedded into renormalization theory because the parameters we are interested in now are infinite renormalizable parameters in this quadratic-like sense. And it turns out that in order to make progress in this problem, we need to have some uniform geometric control of this normalization, control which is called a priori bounds. A priori bounds means, very generally, conceptually, it means that the set of renormalizations is pre-compact in our space of dynamical systems. Or it means that we have some uniform control of all scales of our dynamical systems, uniform geometric control, rough but uniform geometric control in all scales. But in the particular case of the renormalizations that we discuss, it just means that the moduli of the fundamental annuli of all the normalization bounded away from zero. And the modulus of the annulus is just the basic and unique, it is a unique conformal invariant of the annulus, which is in uniformizing coordinate can be given as the logarithm of this radius r. So as long as the annuli don't degenerate, don't become too thin, then we have this uniform geometric control. And from this uniform geometric control, we might be able to deduce MLC. I put here quotation marks because there is no such a theorem, but we never a priori bounds are proved, actually. So people are able to go forward and to prove MLC at the corresponding parameter values. So it is kind of meta principle. Okay, but the problem, there is one problem, is that the a priori bounds are not always true. And in particular, for satellite normalizations, they may fail. For some type of satellite normalizations, infinite normalizable maps of satellite types, they fail. But still, the one can conjecture, it is a reasonable conjecture, so that a priori bounds might be true for primitive renormalizations, for infinite renormalizable maps, which are renormalizable in the primitive sense. And it is already, it is an indication of this very big difference between satellite and primitive types, normalization types. And so first, which I would like to tell you about, to summarize, is the progress in this conjecture. So one of the theorems which was proven about 10 years ago, maybe a little more, with Jeremy Kahn and myself, is that this conjecture is true under molecule condition, under certain molecule condition. And this molecule condition essentially means that we are not only primitive, that normalizations that we consider are not only primitive, but they stay uniformly away from satellite type. So roughly speaking, it means, well, it's actually almost precise. It means that if you take the little copies of the Mandelbrot set responsible for these normalizations which are involved, then these little copies should be not only primitive, but they should stay away from the molecule of the Mandelbrot set. And the molecule of the Mandelbrot set is defined as the main cardioid, then all components, hyperbolic components, which bifurcate from the main cardioid, then all which are bifurcate. I need to refresh the screen. Okay, now it is better, yes. So all main, you take main cardioids and all components that bifurcate from the main cardioid, then all components which further bifurcate from those components, etc. All these components are obtained through satellite renormalization. So this molecule, so is a set of parameters renormalizable in the satellite sense. And then you just require that your primitive components stay some distance away from this molecule. So there is some separation, some definite primitiveness of your components. And then there, under this assumption of definite primitiveness, we proved a priori bounds and MLC. And the tool which was used here is working in near degenerate regime. So, which means that you analyze so conformal moduli of your quadratic-like maps, so which are almost degenerate. So, and somehow we carry through the principle put forward by Jeremy Kahn that if the life is bad today, then it was much worse 10 days before. So if in some small scale, in some scale, you have almost degeneration, then in some shallow scale, you will have even bigger degeneration. And of course, then in some shallow scale, you have even bigger degeneration, and it leads to a contradiction. So one can realize this principle in this situation, and one of our main tools was so-called covering lemma, which gives an estimate of the moduli of the annuli of transformations of the moduli of the annuli under maps which have in principle high degree on the outer domain, but on some smaller domain it has small degree, and there is in near degenerate regime there are some estimates which depend only on this small degree rather than on the big degree. This covering lemma produces a tool to pull the information from deep scale to shallow scales, and to realize this, to carry through this principle, Jeremy's principle of life. Okay, so that was one theorem, and then we moved forward and proved some theorem beyond this one, which allowed us to the little copies of the Mandelbrot set, it's still primitive copies, and these little copies are allowed to converge to the cusp of the Mandelbrot set in some particular selection of these copies. And if you consider this type of renormalization, there is some time renormalization which we call elephant eye condition, then under this type, we were always able to prove a priori bounds. And this type includes bounded type or unbounded type, some mixed types as well, but it does not cover this molecule condition from the previous lemma. And it also required some new tools, some fine uniform control of almost degenerate Riemann surfaces that I think that I don't have, unfortunately, don't have time to specify, because I would like to say a little bit more what happens beyond the primitive case. But basically, that is the status of this conjecture, that there are priori bounds in the primitive case. So it is true if we stay away uniformly away from the satellite, if normalization stay uniformly away from the satellite, and it is true for some specific types which converge to the cusp. That is as much as we can do for today with primitive type. But you see, there is this convergence to the cusp, and the cusp point is a very special point which has attracted huge deal of attention since 80s as well. So there is a big theory developed at this parabolic point, and for perturbations of this parabolic point, it's called parabolic renormalization, and parabolic implosions, which was designed by Doherty and Lavar, and then developed by Mitsuo Shishikuri and many other people. So we did not use, by the way, this theory, because we have to work in almost degenerate regime. So this theory is not really applicable, but it is in the sort of not degenerate regime, it is very powerful theorem. So there is some renormalization, as you can see, associated with these maps, so maps which are close to this cycle, different type of renormalization. Again, I don't have time to define it. So it controls the cauliflower, its parameter, Julia said, for parameter 1/4, and its perturbations, that is a small perturbation of the cauliflower, it explains these shapes, which are called implosive Julia sets, and it also controls, so the elephants, so the limbs of the Mandelbrot set, at least potentially it gives a control of the limbs of the Mandelbrot set, which go to the cusp, somehow cusp on this picture is on the left. And what I would like to mention that there were a theory by Ina Shashikura a priori bounds for these types of renormalization. So it is also some control of some annuli, some conformal annuli of certain moduli for these types of renormalization, and which gives a very good, very strong control of perturbations of the parameter one quarter. So on the main cardioid, particularly on the main cardioid. So if you take on the main cardioid a parameter with rotation number N1, N2, et cetera, of sufficiently high type, so all these Ni are sufficiently big, so it is entries of the continued fraction expansion. If they are all sufficiently big, then just apply Ina Shashikura theorem, that Ina Shashikura theorem becomes a very powerful tool for analyzing this situation. And in particular, so it allowed people to give a full description of the neutral dynamics of this type. So somehow, if you take a neutral map like that, neutral quadratic map with certain rotation number theta, then it could be either Ziegler map such that the boundary of the Ziegler disk is a Jordan curve, or it can be some maps with hairy Ziegler disk. The post-critical set of this map will be some Jordan domain with hairs, or it can be some hedgehog in the Kramer situation, the post-critical set of the post-critical set, so could be a hedgehog, which all this can be explicitly described and classified fully for sufficiently type types, sufficiently high types. Not directly, doesn't look directly related to the MLC, but actually this type of results, this type of bounds and results have relevance to MLC in particular. So Davut Charanyi and Mitsuo Shashikura moved forward to prove MLC for some maps which are infinitely normalizable of growing satellite type. So it is unbounded type. The periods must grow with certain rate. Rate was specifically sort of defined, which guarantees MLC and these parameters. It was the first result about MLC in the satellite for satellite type renormalizations. And it is fairly recent, so maybe 4 or 5 years ago. Okay, 3 or 5 years ago. Okay, so that is the situation. That is the situation for near parabolic parameters. And now I will take 5 more minutes to describe the one more type of renormalization, which is quite recent as well, so introduced several years ago. It is Pac-Man renormalization. The Pac-Man map is some relative of quadratic-like maps, but so you have a domain like that, and it is mapped onto the domain like that, onto the disk, in the following way. If you remove here a ray gamma 1 and remove in the disk gamma some ray gamma node, then it is double branch covering. But so it is like quadratic like situation, but with cutting off certain rays. And you can define Pac-Man renormalization by cutting off certain sector, gluing together certain rays and considering the return maps to this domain. So it is some Pac-Man, some new renormalization which we hoped would give us a control of the Julia of the Mandelbrot set near the main cardioid, just off the main cardioid. And so this normalization was introduced in the joint work with Dima Dutko and Nikita Selinger. And we proved some hyperbolicity theorem for this normalization. The upshot is the following of this theorem. Consider the space of Pac-Man, infinite dimensional space of dynamical systems, and think that quadratic family is inside of this space. It is just one parameter, some curve in this space, our quadratic family. It is not quite so, but it is after one normalization, it will be so. So we have a quadratic family. Start to renormalize this family under this Pac-Man normalization. You obtain some sequence of families which will converge to certain curve in our space, which represent some global global transcendental family of dynamical systems. Already not algebraic, not polynomial, but transcendental family. And you may try to understand this transcendental family, which captures the small scale structure of the quadratics family. So it is kind of small scale, it's some zoom in limits of the Mandelbrot set are captured by this transcendental family. And you can try to analyze it by means of the transcendental dynamics. And that is what we did with Dima.co, which just revealed some external ray structure in this family, in the dynamical plane, in parameter plane. So I mean, it is not that we were able to prove everything we wanted to prove, but a sort of at least on the we proved something and we made some conjectures, and these conjectures turned out to be quite relevant to the problem we are discussing. So I have to move on. So it is just the place of the Mandelbrot set, which is controlled by this Pac-Man normalization. It is just the golden mean rotation number on the main cardioid. And it is the corresponding dynamical picture. And it is just some indications of external structure of our transcendental dynamical systems in our family. So just people can see this external rays. They can for these dynamical systems, and its corresponding picture, it's the conjectural picture at this moment of the external structure of the rays in the parameter plane. And what we proved with Dima, usually using this structure, is that there is some class, we specified some class of satellite renormalizations of bounded type, even of stationary type. It includes unbounded type as well, but for what is most important for us, that it included bounded, and in particular stationary type or renormalization in which MLC holds. And believe it or not, but it was the first example. So now it was the first examples of this type of parameters at which the MLC is established. So the primitive case was covered long ago by the theorem of Jeremy, generalized by the molecule theorem that I formulated. It is part of the molecule theorem, but the satellite case is so much different that it took another couple of decades in order to specify some parameters, not all parameters, but still some parameters are now covered by the MLC conjecture. Let me finish with this brief mentioning that we went on with Dima to prove uniform a priori bounds for neutral, for the Pac-Man renormalization on the main cardioid, on the whole main cardioid of the Mandelbrot set. The bounds of, which is kind of in the spirit similar to Inner-Shishikura bound. So Inner-Shishikura bound work near the cusp of the Mandelbrot set, and we proved similar. I have to refresh. Thank you. So Inner-Shishikura bounds work here near the cusp, and we proved the similar bounds. It is very recent result, not released. The manuscript is not released yet, but we have these bounds on the main cardioid, and in particular, it allows potentially, since that it should be quite straightforward, but we did not check any details, it potentially allows to describe neutral dynamics for all rotation numbers now, not only for rotation numbers of high type, as I formulated before, but for all rotation numbers. So we will have this classification of neutral dynamics as Jordan disk, hairy Jordan disks, or hedgehogs with particular explicitly described structure. And it is also a theorem with near degenerate regime. So a theorem which is proved in the near degenerate regime, implying, so using some version of Jeremy's principle, but working in the opposite direction. Okay, two more slides. So that is a slide which shows the molecule of the Mandelbrot set. Actually, it is the whole Mandelbrot set, but let us consider the molecule of the Mandelbrot set. And let us consider this picture, which looks like this molecule, actually, exactly like this molecule, except that it's a dynamical picture. It is a Julia set for this cubic polynomial, which happens to be part of the Inner-Shishikura theorem, somehow incidentally, but we have this Julia set, and this Julia set looks like exactly like the molecule of the Mandelbrot set. And there is an amusing version of the MLC conjecture for the satellite normalization, which would tell us that this molecule is naturally dynamically homeomorphic to this field Julia set. The normalization on the molecule is actually conjugate to the dynamics of this cubic polynomial on the Julia set, on this Julia set. And it is kind of just different version, different amusing version to formulate the MLC conjecture for for the satellite type renormalization. Okay, the last slide, and I four types of renormalization. So the primitive renormalization, which so applies somewhere here in the Mandelbrot set, satellite renormalization, which applies on the molecule of the Mandelbrot set, so closer to the main cardioid. Then almost parabolic normalization, which applies here near the cusp, and the Pac-Man normalization, which applies on the main cardioid and in some neighborhood of this main cardioid, hopefully in the whole molecule. So we have these four normalization types. We have some theorems which give a priori bounds for any of these normalizations, and these a priori bounds lead to some local connectivity results. So the hope that this dark region in between, so there is this dark region in between primitive and satellite, can be squeezed to the empty set. So, and it can be done, hopefully it can be done in finite time. So, but that is a kind of the status, the pictures, or the hope that these four types of renormalizations could be sufficient in order to deal completely with the Mandelbrot set. Okay, thank you for your attention.